Good evening, everybody, and welcome along to the Super League for GPVWC. It's round 13 of 18 as we return from the month-long summer break, and what a wonderful place to come back to as well. The Autodromo di Monza, a calendar favourite of many, and good to see it actually quite recently making progress in remaining a crucial part of the Formula One calendar as well. It's here to stay, and hopefully you'll be here to stay with us for the next hour to 2 hours, where we will hopefully see a fantastic racer. If you have not discovered already, his Geordiness, Joshua Anderson, is not here today. He's currently on his way back from holiday, so I'm afraid you're going to have to deal with me for now, James Kirk. But alongside me, firstly on cameras, is Mr. Menno Klonter, filling in as he is a star, always. But on co-commentary, a familiar face at least, Kacper, Kolodziejczyk. Welcome, Kacper.
Well, hello.
We've just witnessed qualifying, and we've got a couple of really interesting breaking stories, actually. So first and foremost, we should just say that pole position was taken by Eros Meschulli. That is his third pole position of the year, his second consecutive pole position after taking pole back in Spa before the summer break, so continuing his good form. But we have a very interesting story concerning Nordschen, don't we, Kacper? Because they qualified quite well within the top 10.
Very well indeed. But it's very interesting. Yes, engine issues indeed. It's very weird. They're the only team to have engines that are below 82%, if I recall correctly. Mm. And they're as low as 51 and 54%. That is massive.
Yeah, it sort of brings back memories. I remember watching, I think it was Abu Dhabi 2014, where both the Hawkeyes, the team made a similar blunder, and they ended up both retiring from the race about 60-70% of the way in. Monza isn't exactly one of the heaviest on engines necessarily. Yes, it's got plenty of straights, but it's only really down the main straight where you're actually maxing out and really testing the ends of this engine. So is it going to be something which they're going to be worried about, or is it just a case of damage limitation for this round?
I think they will be worried about it for sure. I mean, what was it, 70-something or 80-something% of this track is driven with a full throttle, so you're still putting stress on the engine while accelerating and going at near top speed anyway, so I'd say it is quite heavy. Either way, I think what's more important in this, actually here, it will be the lack of power that you get, the slight degradation of power that you get with the engine usage, so that's something to watch out for.
Other big stories concern the top team. So first and foremost, Filip Puszka, current championship leader, not here today. He's being filled in by David Franchich, who had a solid scoring last night in the Super Cup. We apologize for no broadcast, by the way, but no camera person. There we are. He scored an 8th and a 9th last round in Super Cup. So he's scored some good points here already, and always reliable for the Vauxhall team. We're also missing, however, Michael Francesconi for Adonis Engineering. Recent wheel problems for him. So Dennis Jordan, who also happened to have a very good round in the Super Cup just yesterday, just missing out on the podium in race two, he's going to fill in for Adonis. And talking of that, we should actually talk about the championship, shouldn't we? Adonis Nordschen Vauxhall, miles ahead of the rest of the field so far, over 100 points. Is it hard to look past those three now for the Constructors' Championship, Kacper?
I think with just so few races to go, I think that's pretty much set now. The gap is just too large at this point. Also, just saying that, Francesconi is on the server and actually driving now.
Is he really?
So, yes, he is.
So I guess there will be no Jordan today. But there is a Martin Christensen, who's in a unmarked car. I believe that he shouldn't be here. There we go. So, yeah.
Yes, I think there will be a Dennis is here because he thought he will have to fill in. But at this point, he will have to leave because there's only 30 seconds of warm-up left.
Yeah. Yeah, our race administrator, Chris Williamson, does reserve the right to ban them anyway from, or kick them from the server, I think is the right one. So that should be all right, but Pushka's the big one, obviously the big one missing now, and he's more than likely going to lose his championship lead today. David Fiedek, only 2 points behind Pushka, as of today. And Mashuli, of course, on pole today, only 7 points behind Pushka. So he's already missed a couple of rounds this season. And you do wonder, Kacper, whether that's not going to come back and bite him. I mean, he's done incredibly well. Won the last three races. So it's not like he could do any more than he's already doing. But, you know, if he keeps on missing rounds, then our reigning champion might not find himself reigning anymore.
I mean, yeah, that's pretty much it. It seems like his health is just not allowing him to do it, from what I've been reading in the main story that's on GPVWC website. And it's so sad to see, because he's such a quick driver and so consistent.
There's been a lot of ill people actually recently. There was a number of notable absentees from the Super Cup yesterday as well.
I agree. I'm not sure what it is with this time of the year, this year specifically, but I've seen multiple sick people. In other places I've seen as well, just people who would never miss rounds, just being sick and not able to drive.
Also, to Menno, apparently the broadcast says Formula Challenge, not Super League. So quickly amend that for our viewers. But yeah, it's bizarre. It's almost like a yearly European bug that goes round, and unfortunately for our championship leader, not gone his way. 53 laps of racing action is to come. Not one of the longest races, Monza. In fact, it's one of the shortest. You need to get your moves and overtakes and your good starts and your pit stops done in as good a time as possible to be successful around this 5.8-kilometer circuit. Yes. Just looking at the top six, Mashuli, Gaia, Columbus, or Fiduk, DeVos, sorry, that was the top five. We've got an interesting group of cars there. The two Nordschans, as we've already gone over, engine issues, could be a bit wobbly near the end of the race. So I guess for Mashuli, Columbus, and of course DeVos, Kerner having an amazing campaign this time around in 2016. Are they going to be the favourites for the win? I mean, especially Mashuli, who's looking for his third race win of the season.
Yeah, I think considering his speed here, if he can just manage to fend off Fiduk, I think he'll be fine. Although, that's not to say Fiduk's not going to try.
And, oh, of course.
But yes, I think he is in with a good chance. But we've seen him try this last time around and just wasn't quite able to do it. But then again, he did finish second behind Pushka, so it's not a given by any means.
And actually, let's just play devil's advocate for a bit on the Nordschan issue. If they get to the end of the race with this engine, then they will, I know they won't exactly have saved another engine necessarily, but they're going to have a full power 100% unit to use at another track. So
yeah, maybe they just feel like this is the track that they won't lose as much for some reason. Maybe because of the acceleration being having a lot less acceleration in general around here, and it's more about the actual top speed. I'm not entirely sure. I guess it's a tactical decision as well, or blunder, one of the two.
They did seem to have the best speeds in the speed trap though as well, all thanks to that Martex engine. They are the sole people there, effectively the McLaren Honda of our field, except, you know, good. So we'll have to wait and see. As I say, 53 laps to decide what is going to happen. Leading us off on pole though, Eros Mashuli, third in the championship by 7 points away from the leader. He starts there for Adonis Engineering alongside him. Florian Geyer for a potentially hindered Nordschan racing car. We will see how he fares as the race progresses. Mindaugas Columbus, in with a good chance of winning today's race. His only race win this season came at Bahrain. That was with Torrent Motorsports. I wonder whether he might get his first win for Vodbol here today. And then, of course, David Fiduk, the 2014 Drivers Champion. 2 points behind Pushka. He will start P4 for Nordschan Racing. Bart De Vos will start P5. Very good qualifying once again in the Kernout for the Belgian, with David Franchich filling in for Philip Pushka. P6 for the Vodbol, so Vodbol starting very well despite being a champion down. Emmanuel Geschella for Storm will start in P7 with Kernow's Daniel Brewer, P8. Tom Parker puts in a pretty good effort for the Green Stripes racing car in P9. And Tobias Olsen, who's filling in for Dawe Tapper today over at Nijo Racing, a really good qualifying effort actually from the Swede to take it into the top 10. Always questions about his racecraft though. Will he be able to make it to the end? Lewis Redshaw, who enjoyed such a strong start to the campaign for Woods, been falling a bit back recently. He starts P11 with Adrian McNaughton starting P12 for Storm. Redshaw's teammate Roy Schroten, who's been in the points a couple of times in the past few rounds, he starts P13 with Daniel Benefield P14 in the Red Archer team. We then have Devidas Misoulis rounding out the point scorers in P15. The Ninja Racing with Niranjan Kumar making his Super League debut with Hawkeye Racing, the lone Hawkeye here today. Fran Lopez, after issues of his own pre-qualifying, starts P17 for Red Archer with Gergo Baldi heading off the Wouters in P18. His teammate for today, Thomas Hinz, will start P19 with Ben Horrell, P20 in the Green Stripes car. And Michael Francesconi will start from pit lane after failing to qualify. And he's on the hard compound as well, Francesconi, so looking for a longer stint. By the way, back of the grid penalties were served out there to Baldi. Hinz and Horrell. So those are the only two with back of the grids to serve. Interesting choice from Francesconi, though, Kacper, looking to go long in that first stint.
Yeah, interesting. I think he's one of the only two drivers on the harder compound, yes. And it could be very interesting. Maybe he's trying to just get that bit longer first stint, but we've seen this season that the harder compound often just does not work. So I wonder if he is going to be able to make it work this round. We've seen a lot of time drivers trying to minimize the very last stints, pitting in 5-10 laps before the end just to limit it.
Well, if you're going to go long at any track on hard compound tyres, it's going to be Monza, one of the least degrading tracks on the calendar, of course. The question is, will he be able to heat them up? Will he be able to get any sort of good traction? Will he be able to get any good times? It's time to find out who's going to win this race, though. We have four lights, we have five. And here at the Autodromo di Monza, we are racing. And it's a good start there from Mashuli. Gaia slow off the line. Columbus spun up a little bit in second gear. There's certainly plenty in the mid-pack. We've had better starts and all a Red Archer there getting into contact with someone in the midfield. But into turn one, Columbus trying around the outside of Gaia, not able to do anything. Bart De Vos has had a great start there. He's jumped Fydek. After the Retafilio chicane, Gashella up to P6, Francis down to P7. Redshaw's had a good start. He's up to P9, and Tom Parker similarly. He's fallen back a bit, I think. Parker down to P10. Oh, is that a couple of people off? No, it's just my graphics. But Mashuli leading crucially. Ahead of Gaia, who's holding off Columbus now as we head through the Delarogier chicane with everybody. Seems like Benefield was the lone person to get into any sort of grief there. Francesconi's still not allowed. I think he's just leaving the pit lane now since everybody has passed the Sector 1 split. Thomas Hinz in a bit of grief, I think, there. Horrell with a decent start. But Mashuli, his job now will be to try and pull away from the rest of the field. Gaia and Columbus attempting to keep tabs, but we've got a massive battle here behind David Fydek, who's gotten back past Bart De Vos, actually. And Emmanuel Gashella there is in close pursuit as well. The Romanian looking to get past the Belgian in front of him as quickly as possible. I think Gashella certainly on race pace, looking like he's in with a very good chance of a podium as we stream towards Parabolica. Mashuli taking it nicely. Nobody looking for early moves just yet, although Rachel's just gone past Parker. A couple of people going in side by side. But at the end of lap one, then, it is Mashuli who leads from Gaia, Columbus, Fydek, De Vos, Gashella, Francic, Brewer, Redshaw, and Parker rounding out the top 10.
Wow. Okay, there is side-by-side action of Fydek and Bart De Vos coming to first corner, but no, it's a bit easier going. But Gashella nearly hit Bart De Vos going to the Parabolica braking. It's quite close, and the tyre is just not quite on the brakes yet.
Roy Schroten there just getting past Tobias Olsen into turn one as well, so the sweep down to P12.
Actually,
after a strong qualifying. And
Bart De Vos
up.
And Gazzella, they're trying side by side through the second chicane.
And that didn't end up well, did it? A couple of people with brake problems of some sort, and Gazzella ending up the worst of them. Seems like Parker had a bit of a stream as well. It was really weird. So Fydek eventually gets away scot-free because of that. No one behind him now. Francic benefits massively. He's up to P5. De Vos down to P6. Brewer up to P7. Redshaw up to P8. On the back of Brewer now as well. And Gashella down to P9. We will follow this battle between Redshaw and Brewer, the two English compatriots going side by side into Ascari. There's a bit of battling there with the other Woods. And oh, wow, Redshaw around the outside of Ascari. This will be a great move if he can take it all the way around the outside. What a move from Lewis Redshaw. That was so early in the race as well.
And now Gacella is trying to go by Brewer, but then he gets a bit of slipstream from Redshaw and tries to go on the inside of Parabolica.
Yeah, and that was good. The good return move there from Bruin. Here comes Kashela now. He didn't take that move into Parabolica early, but he might benefit here on the cutback. We saw this a couple of times in Formula Challenge and Super Cup in the last couple of days. And oh, look at that, getting so close to three of them, going three wide into the Retaviglio. Kashela smartly deciding to back out of that one. Everyone going through single file, or just about.
Wow. So basically. So basically, Redshaw did the exact same thing that Brewer did to him as a corner earlier.
Kashela up the inside. Sorry, Kashela up the inside of Kerber Grande. He's just taking that position right back. Redshaw going to go on the inside of the De La Roche. A bit of contact there as well. And Kashela forced wide. I think he's going to retake that position. Indeed, he is. The two remaining battling side by side into Lesmo 1. Redshaw around the outside of Kashela. What a great scrap between this lot. And Daniel Brewer says, thank you very much. He's going to clock out for now.
Wow. So he's basically the exact same as Fidok, just having a bit of that breather thanks to other two behind clashing. Oh, very lucky for the two.
That's a brilliant battling from all of them. And we should note behind as well, there's been quite a lot of shifting as well. Tobias Olsen back into the top 10. Fran Lopez has had a great start so far. The young Spaniard up to P11, although he's just, as soon as they come to him, had a bit of an off-track moment there at Ascari. This might allow Roy Schroten into attack that P11, although the Woods does not look fast in a straight line. And indeed, heading into the Parabolica, he almost outbroke himself, and that will allow Masulis through surely up the inside of the Parabolica. On exit, we go very close between the two of them, side by side, almost locking wheels on exit. Be careful, guys, it's only lap 4 of 53, there's still a long way to go. And Roy Schroten thankfully able to stay ahead in his eyes, although Masulis is going to try and attack back outside of the Retaviglio. No, Roy Schroten is going to hold on to that for now. Ben Horrell, P14, he's back into the points there. Adrian McNaughton seemingly having a bad time of it there. He's down to P15. And those who are interested in where Francesconi is after all of this, he's already up to P17.
Yeah, I think with him having such a quick car, he's going to be able to go up into the points easily if he can just keep it together. He already is on the back of the train behind Benefield, who actually, just as I say that, makes a bit of a mistake out of the second chicane. But yeah, I think he's going to be able to get into points and possibly even quite high points with the problems that he had beforehand and not getting quite enough practice and qualifying.
Oh, for sure. I mean, if there's any series which you would want to start from pit lane in, it would probably be Super League, where there is such a long amount of time. Talking about longest amount of time, though, that is something that Masulis does not have on his hands. He's constantly attacking and constantly defending here. He's got Schroten ahead of him. He's got Horrell behind him, who's just gone off a Sky. Once again, a couple of people done that already. That might allow him to be susceptible to the slipstream of McNaughton behind. Nothing to do into Parabolica, though. Benefield in close pursuit of that as well, looking for more points, the Aussie. But a great little battle here in the midfield. There's great battles going up, going on up top as well. We'll just stick with Masulis quickly.
About to attack Schroten.
Yeah, and going down the inside this time, probably the ideal route. Will he break later, though? Oh, yeah, he does. He breaks it a little bit. He had that initial break, didn't he? Then let it go, broke a little bit more, and that is P12 for the Lithuanian behind. There is a little move going on. Look at this, Daniel Benefield just getting past Adrian McNaughton. Bit of lag there from the Aussie, getting very close. I don't know how they didn't spin each other. McNaughton now on the inside of the De La Roche, though, and he takes that position back.
But McNaughton making a bit of a mistake, just not having enough traction out of the second chicane, and he's on the inside of Lesmo, but just not quite able to take it.
Benefield around the outside, and they're going side by side now, and here comes Francesconi, bit of contact between the two. Around the outside of Lesmo 2 goes Benefield. That's not going to work out for him at all, and contact between the two.
That was a big one.
Really, really poor, unfortunately. Benefield trying to hold on in there. McNaughton loses his rear wing and his front wing. Benefield loses his front wing. And it looks like both of those are going to try and get back to the pit, but that was a little bit opportunistic from Benefield, who becomes our first retirement of the race.
And I think McNaughton, even if he does get back into pits, he's not going to be able to repair that very quickly, if at all, with the rear wing damage.
And sorry, just looking further, going back into the midfield, sorry, Ben Horrell's just gotten past Roy Schroten into the Parabolica, so Ben Horrell up to P13. Next on his target list will be Davidas Masulis. Apparently, we've got another move even further back. Effectively, our last two runners bar McNaughton here. Thomas Hinds on the Ranyan Kumar, the Wouters reserve against the Hawkeye debutante here. And going into the Retafilio, Hins on the inside. He's going to keep it very conservative, though. He has to double-check himself. Kumar stays ahead for now, but we've focused a lot on the midfield.
By the way, there's Michulis and Horrell again.
Are they getting at it again? You can't keep your eyes off him.
Oh,
and Michulis there loses it under braking. Very bizarre incident. And, oh, that's good avoiding there from Tom Parker. He was another person who's fallen down the order. And, oh, that's a real shame for Michulis, who falls to the very back, as I say, bar McNaughton. So benefiting from that, Ben Horrell, who's up to P12, although he goes very wide there. At Lesmo 2, might allow Roy Schroeder to look back in. Francescone now back into the points in P14, because it seems like Tom Parker's had an instance somewhere. He's down to P15, so it's all action off the start. We can't even keep an eye on what's going up front. I'm going to tell you now, Michulis ahead by 2.2 seconds.
Wow, what in the world is even happening? So we have a problem from Roy Schroeder, apparently.
I believe there was some lagging, and he lagged into the crowd of Roy.
He's about to be overtaken by Francescone, who nearly goes into the very back of him.
That car does not look good at all. It seems like on the brakes, he's very conservative, we'll say. I would expect Francescone to overtake Schroeder very shortly. To be fair, though, it looks like Schroeder's had a pretty good exit out of the Parabolica. So for Michael at the moment, that move is not going to happen. Will be worth keeping a little beady eye on it, though. As we head into the Curva Grande, another chance for the Italian to slipstream. I think there is DRS around here. It's either here or on the back straight. Looking at Francesconi's rear wing, definitely the back straight, I'd say. Here he comes then into the Della Roger chicane. Still nothing doing. But as I say, that's probably a move that's probably going to happen in the near future. Worth looking up at the front, though. Mashuli leads by 2.2 seconds. Sorry, there's been another move midfield. Oh, who's out with a spin? Lewis Redshaw. Lesmo 2 causing all sorts of issues for drivers today. Redshaw falling down behind Gashella, Olsen, and Lopez now. Back to P11.
That's very odd. In my experience, the Lesmo 2 is never as big of an issue, really. It's always Lesmo 1 that's the bigger one, as Lopez just goes a bit wide through Ascari.
How has nobody called him Flopez before as a nickname?
I don't know, but it does look like this on my label.
you got a new nickname, Fran. I apologize. I spend one day here and already stuff happens. Lewis Redshaw getting a little bit onto the dirty stuff as well on the exit parabolic. He's a fast driver, though. I'm sure he's going to look to get past Lopez and Olsen. Who should be said, Lopez and Olsen doing very good jobs so far, running inside the top 10, keeping it nice and consistent. That's exactly what you want to see from A, your reserve driver, and B, a driver who's had to come back from a difficult qualifying.
Yes, it's good to see Red Archer being so high up, and if he is the sole driver, and he is and if he's up here, it's really good to see. Of course, we've seen Red Archer do really well during Spa, at least in the qualifying. I can't recall, it's been over a month ago, but if I recall correctly, Red Archer had some upgrades for the even though we thought they're over in the last race. So it's a bit of a funny story, this car.
It's not exactly the campaign that they would want either. They've gone from such stability to such instabilities. It looks like Tom Parker there. Oh, dear. That is another car which has lost its rear wing and its front wing. And let's see how that happened into the Della Roger chicane. Oh, just completely lost it on exit. Avoided the wall on the outside of the corner and then ended up... Oh, no, it was on the inside, sorry. Then went into the outside wall. So Gergo Baldi, therefore, inherits the last point position of the day for now, at least.
Yes. Also, just a little update. McNaughton is actually still driving, and he was able to repair his rear wing, and he is driving at speed now. So that's at least good to see him still driving.
Not driving, though, is Tom Parker, who's decided to aptly park it, and he becomes our second retirement of the day, unfortunately. And so that leaves us with trying to find the battle, and I do think that this midfield is really where we're going to be finding everything. Olsen, Lopez, Redshaw, Horrell, Schroeder, Francescone, I mean, all those positions are interchangeable, all of them covered by the better part of about 7 seconds for now. I think it's probably worth having a little look at Francescone as he still attempts to get past Roy Schroeder, the Dutchman, holding on resolutely currently.
To be honest, by the way, there is one battle slightly brewing, and it's slowly the gap is slowly windling down. It's not very much at all. It's the battle for the second place. If you look at Columbus, he's very close behind the guy who just made a mistake.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, dear.
Indeed. We'll keep an eye on this now then. Florian Geyer down the back straight. Columbus really tucked up nicely in the stretch. And keep in mind, these guys only 3 seconds behind Mashuli as well. But look at that top speed from the Nordschen there. Able to stay ahead of the Vodball well enough. But now we've got yet another long straight to have to deal with. And this is where Geyer, I'm sure, is going to be counting his blessings for having the fastest car in the speed traps, because he's got possibly the best car to defend here. That said, Columbus now has DRS at its control, but still no attempt on that position. So the Nordschen's showing some real good legs here.
Yes, it's again very surprising considering they would seem to be a bit lower on power with all that usage on the engine already. I'm surprised that they're doing so well still.
As further back, sorry, Fran Lopez has just got past Tobias Olsen into turn one, as has Francesconi on Schroten. So, as I say, you can't take your eyes off this midfield battle for long. Lopez into P9, Francesconi into P13.
Well, again, Francesconi is just doing what he can to negate any all the damage he can. But what is very, very much impressive is how fast he is on that harder tire.
Yeah.
It's still slower, mind you, than the leaders. And it is slower by about a second and a half a lap. But it's still very quick. And he is very consistent, as it looks.
He's making a lot of time here as well. I realize that he's having to get through traffic, but he's dealing with the traffic now rather than potentially later in the race when he'd be on the faster tire.
Yeah, although when you're in the faster tire, it's obviously a bit easier to overtake as well. But yes, it is still surprising how fast he is and how he is still able to actually get in front of traffic and actually...
Right. Sorry, you're going to have to go back to P2 and P3 here. Columbus on Gaia once again. Still, DRS fully open. Columbus not able to get past. You just have to wonder whether that Vodball's going to have to try something a little bit different to get past the Nordschen here, because it is really struggling.
Yes, he will have to do something creative. You can see him being a lot more comfortable out of corners, but just not having quite enough top speed.
Oh, and is he just getting onto the grass there, Columbus? I think he was barely on it, but managed to get on the track to be able to break in time. Thankfully, anyway, We'll go through the rest of the order now. David Feideck a further 4 seconds behind this battle, but considering that engine, as we've already gone over, I think Feideck could probably take a P4 at the end of the day, to be honest. Francis a further 3 seconds behind, or 2 seconds behind now, I should say, in P5. De Bos, P6, and Brewer in P7. The Kernow's going well once again. Gashella, P8 with Lopez, P9, and Olsen rounding out the top 10. Rachel's actually quite close to those two, though, in P11, so don't count him out of the top 10 position, with Horrell 12th, Francesconi 13th, and another mistake, sorry, from who?
Geyer.
And here we go then. Columbus rides on the back once again. But look at that top line speed once again. Columbus has to brake early so that he doesn't run into the back of Geyer. It seems that Nordschen, if it does make it to the end of the race, an inspired call.
Indeed. And I think one of the things at the moment, again, this car is set up for the straights. And the Vodball is just a bit more set up for that cornering, better exit, and you can see that in the body language of the car when it's going through corners and exiting especially.
The body language there was, oh, I don't like curbs.
Yes, it was, that was horrible, yes.
Yeah, a bit of treacherous running there from Columbus. And it's kind of understated, actually. Sorry, Francesconi is into the pits.
On the harder tire.
On the harder tire. Now, surely he's going to be going on to the soft compound. Yeah, so I'm guessing a two-stop for Francesconi. He's run his hard tire stint. Doffs off from here until the end?
Yes, I think that's going to be it. I think he just felt like he was losing too much time to the leaders in the fashion he was driving in, even if he was on the harder tire. And it's just... because he knows that the drivers will be trying to minimize the harder tire running at the end as well.
And actually, to be fair, now is the best time to pit, isn't it? Because he's got the most clean air. All the drivers are as close as they are. And then when they come in for their first pit stops, he's just going to gain those positions back without even having to try to overtake them. So very smart thinking there from the Italian. We will see where he figures by the end of the race, of course. You know, this is a very alternative strategy to everyone else, almost the opposite to what everyone else is doing. Speaking yes. of polar opposites, though, it seems like we've got the whole Red Bull-Mercedes argument here, don't we? We've got someone with great top speed in Gaia, someone with great downforce in Columbus, and still for the Lithuanian, it still doesn't work. As further down the order, sorry, Horrell there, I saw him mounting Parabolica for whatever reason. But it seems like him and Redshaw have caught up to Olsen, who comes into the pits. So an early stop for the Swede.
Yes,
and
now...
Redshaw has... Whoa, what is going on with Horrell there? Going completely off track.
I see ping of 1,000 from Horrell. That's...
Oh, yeah.
Oh.
So, we were talking... Well, there were a bit of concerns in practice from Fidek, certainly. He will not be enjoying those driving conditions whatsoever. Either way, Redshaw up into the top 10 now. And where does Olsen figure? He's just going to come back out behind Thomas Hinz in P16. So ahead of Francesconi, that's what he wanted. Onto the soft tyre, though, Olsen. And taking the first chicane horribly as well. So it seems like he's going to be planning for a longer stint on the hard tyre.
Yeah, or he could also try and run as long on these as he can and then put the hard tire late. It seems like he can drive for quite a while on these soft tires here. Again, this track does not have too many super super quick corners, so you just don't wear them as quickly.
I understand where you're coming from on that one, to be honest.
Yeah.
Well, as I say, interesting call. It could be very possible, actually, that he's literally just trying to cover off Francesconi.
I think so, yes.
You look how close he is already. As Vodbol, apparently, Klumbis now on the inside. Now's a chance. He's gone for a late dive, Klumbis, and he has stopped before the corner. Finally, lap after lap of trying, Mindaugas Klumbis has made it into P2. He's got to hold on here around the Curva Grande, though. Guy is going to have the better speed. I mean, yeah, you can see how fast he's closing already. The German looks to the inside, but Klumbis has it covered. Finally, into P2.
But just look at that speed for corners of Vodbol. So much better through there. So much more grip.
I'm just going to say as well, 3.7 seconds off Mashuli. It's hardly like that's not a distance which he could eat up as well. So is the win still there for Klumbis to take?
Possibly. Also, something very interesting happening in the back, just quickly mentioning it. Francesconi just had the quickest lap of the race of anyone, so he is pushing.
That'd be why he's closing on Olsen so quickly. It's, as I say, it's going to be fascinating. He's running in a lot of clean air. That clean air, no doubt, is going to disappear, though, because up ahead he's got Olsen, Hinz, and Misulis all in a little clump. So it's not exactly worked out the way he would have wanted. That said, he is on a fresh pair of boots. So as long as the pace differential is there over Olsen, then he should be able to dispose of him well. Hinz and Misulis, they do have to pit eventually. And actually, looking at Hinz, he's just made a mistake there in P15. This could allow Tobias Olsen in. The two of them, Super Cup runners. And here we go then around the outside. Oh, it seems like Inzi decided this discretion was the better part of Valor. Olsen through, as into the pits now comes Daniel Brewer. P7 into the garage.
What?
What is going on with Daniel Brewer? I wonder, has he had another tech issue? He's suffered with them all year. And
well,
it seems like
that's very odd. He looked like he's just stopping for his pit stop in front of his garage, but then he just turned into his garage itself, like as if he was retiring a car in real life. But obviously, this is not how you do it here. I'm not entirely sure what's happening.
Well, as I say, Brewer is one of those who has suffered with tech issues all throughout the year. It's just one of those things where if you don't have the components, or if you don't have the internet, or if your computer just doesn't like the mod, you're going to get problems. And indeed, there we are, confirmation. Daniel Brewer becomes our third retirement of the day. Suspicious circumstances. I wonder whether it's lag potentially. We should also mention that while that was going on, Michael Francesconi has made his way past Thomas Hinz as well. And the Italian now into P15 as we get onto this Internijo battle. Tobias Olsen very eager to get past his Lithuanian teammate for the day. And I do wonder whether Misulis might just let Olsen go here. It'd be the sensible decision. Indeed, he doesn't. Oh, yes. Just getting back in time to cover off Francesconi. So that's some great team play there from David Aspasoulis, although how long he's going to hold on to that position? Not very long, as Lewis Redshaw, I noticed, just coming into the pits as well. On around the outside here goes Francesconi. He's already passed before they've even hit Parabolica. Misulis up to P15. Francesconi up to P14. We'll see where Lewis Redshaw comes out now.
Francesconi,
he's going to be jumped by Francesconi, isn't he?
Yes, he is, actually. By the way, Francesconi did do another quickest lap of the race the lap before, so he is so quick.
So Redshaw comes out P16, so Francesconi has jumped him, and Lewis Redshaw was around P11,
oh, wow.
So theoretically on this pace is Francesconi now going around the outside of Niranjan Kumar, whom Tobias Olsen overtook into the Retafilia chicane. He's theoretically in P11 at this stage. Because, I mean, actually, to be fair, Tobias Olsen was P10, wasn't he? So he's making up great time.
One wonders how high up Francesconi is going to get after all of the people after all of the pit stops, because we've only seen a handful of people do their pit stops, a handful of drivers. So with him gaining so much time, where is he going to come out in the end? It's going to be very fascinating to see by the end.
Oh, here we go. He's already going for it. Threw it down on Ascari. Tobias Olsen closes the door promptly, says, no, thank you very much. I've got my own race to run here. I'm just looking ahead of Olsen, though, as well here, Kacper. And Francesconi, as it stands, has 14 seconds of clean air to run into. So he's disposed of his backmarker competition here very, very neatly, very effectively. And if he gets past Olsen, possibly now, actually, as Olsen's had a terrible parabolica, he's going to be absolutely laughing. Look at this. Before the DRS alongside, DRS now open for the Adonis car. And surely this is going to be position done by the time
it
we
is.
Hit turn one. A little bit of a lock-up into turn one. Tobias Olsen tries his best to hold on around the outside. Oh,
wow.
How they did not cause contact. Oh, there was a bit of contact on exit, where unbelievably they shouldn't have made contact. That was great racing from the two of them, though. Francesconi comes out on top. Will Olsen respond into the Della Rozier chicane? Francesconi put his car in the middle of the road. Very sensible, good defending. Great racing between
what,
the two of them. That is
what
exactly
driving.
What we want to see.
What a fantastic drive from Olsen and Francesconi. I don't think I've ever seen a move side by side for the first chicane all the way through. That's jaw-dropping stuff right there.
I mean, as I say, with Olsen, you never know what you're going to get. And that is exactly the sort of move that usually would see him spinning a driver. But actually, fair play to Francesconi, giving him the room, racing him well. And okay, there's a bit of contact on exit, but brilliant stuff from the two of them as Emmanuel Gascella now comes into pit from P8. And this will be a real show of where Francesconi is. He's just coming down the back straight now as Gascella leaves his pit stop. That was a really quick stop, actually, from Gascella,
as
Schroten comes in behind him. Where will Gascella come out? So Francesconi is the next car down the road. So Gascella comes out then in P9. And just to confirm then, Francesconi from the back of the grid already into the top 10 after the first pit stop. Roy Schroten just coming out the pits now. Pass goes Misulis, pass goes Redshaw. And he's going to be ahead of Baldi, though, so Schroten figures back out into the field in P15.
Now, I wonder if Francesconi is going to be able to catch up to Gascella, or just... It's a bit of a gap currently, but 5 seconds from what I'm seeing. Or actually, 4 seconds.
Well, let's take it like this, shall we? 20 seconds, roughly, a pit stop in these cars, as I noticed Olsen gets the Della Rozier terribly wrong there. 20 seconds, so we'll say 28 seconds is probably a safe window behind the leader to be pitting. If so, that means that he's going to gain another position from Ben Horrell, who I just noticed has just been off at Ascari as well. So Francesconi should technically be P9 after all the pit stops have figured out. Just looking at everyone going round again, seems like nobody's deciding to bail into the pits just yet. I'm guessing the next one might very well be Ben Horrell, as Adrian McNaughton unfortunately decided to call it a day as well, P4. And indeed, Ben Horrell just comes into the pits now. Yep. His tyre's not holding on. So Gascella will therefore move up into P8, and Francesconi will be up to P9.
Yeah, that is quite an amazing feat to start from pits and being, and 34, basically one third of the race in, being in ninth place already. Kind of shows you the speed that the Adonis car has. Just how well developed it is, really, and then how quick of the both drivers in those cars are, considering his teammate is leading the race.
Just saying here, Ben Horrell might just have timed this pit stop perfectly, or maybe not so perfectly. Oh no, Niranjan Kumar gets out ahead of Ben Horrell. He is yet to pit the Indian, so Horrell has traffic here to deal with. Olsen up into P10, by the way, so Horrell.
Oh, but
be
look at Horrell.
As let's see. Oh, that's a bit of lag there as well. He's deciding to go down the inside now. Oh wow, that is that car is all over the place, and I can understand completely why Kumar was at wit's end there, and that's actually massively put him at a disadvantage. Redshaw there going through to P12, not that it matters. Kumar does need to pit. As further up, David Francic now comes in for his first pit stop of the day from P6. So Fran Lopez will be going through to P7. I think Bart DeVos actually was P6, so he's up to P5. We'll see where Francic figures here. He should be coming out comfortably ahead of Gashella. Remember, right at the end of the pit lane, since they are the reigning champions, Wobble. And indeed, out he comes now, well ahead of Gashella. In fact, almost the entire pit straight ahead of Gashella. So David Francic uniquely out into P7. It seems like those top seven now are, maybe, of course, barring Francis, quite a ways away from everyone below them.
Yes, I think they are quite safe in that sense. As Francesconi just bet another lap record, that Francesconi just keeps on putting laps in that are faster than anyone else on the track. Amazing stuff.
And he is indeed catching Gashella. We should talk about the lead gap, by the way. We did say it was about 3.8 seconds. It's been fluctuating between Mashuli and Columbus, and it's fluctuating pretty much around what it is now, 3.5 seconds. So you do wonder whether the swing of this race will actually depend on how good the guys are when they hop onto the alternative tire compound. Because, I mean, I've not really been watching the series much this year. I know the stats, but I don't know in particular whether any driver or any car is good on the hard tire ahead of other people. Nope, they're all the same.
Simply put, it seems like no one likes the hard tires. They're being avoided like the plague. I think pretty much the only times people did drivers did try to drive on the hard tire.
I'm just going to say here, Columbus has made a massive mistake at the Delarogier chicane, and he's come back on the road, but he could be susceptible to an attack from Gaia here. David Francic is ahead of Bart DeVos, who's just pitted, so DeVos back out into P7, but Columbus there missed his braking zone massively, actually went onto the grass, went across the Delarogier, and now is under a lot of pressure from Gaia. But back to you.
Yes, by the way, Francesconi hit another lap record. One after another.
Bang.
Yes, but either way, yes, the drivers usually avoid the hard tires like the plague, and usually when they do try them, they tend to give up on even attempting to drive on them after about 5 or 10 laps, depending on the track, so it's really pointless, and usually you see drivers spinning in about 5 laps before the end just to have that rule applied, really. So, yeah, it's a tire that just does not work for anyone.
Kumar has been in and out, and he rejoins the last of the 17 runners still on track here today. For those guys who are interested in quantifying an amount of just how much Columbus lost to Mashuli from that mistake, 3.5 seconds. That's doubled Mashuli's lead. And he has gained a little bit back on Mashuli the last lap, Columbus. He had a stellar last sector there, bringing it down by about 0.3. But this is going to give Gaia a nice little sniff for P2, because it seemed like the Lithuanian had completely lost touches. There's a further movement further down the field as Fran Lopez comes in for his pit stop. He's going to be jumped by Emmanuel Gashella. And what about Francesconi here? Oh, you know what? He's got him. Francesconi up to P8. Fran Lopez down to P9.
Wow. That's amazing. That is so amazing pace. And wait, I'm just seeing something. Fran Lopez, as we were talking about tires, he just went on the harder tire in the Red Archer.
Alternative strategy, and that might explain why he came out behind Francesconi and not ahead of him.
Yes, and Francesconi didn't beat his own lap time this time around, but he still had the record sector in the last sector, so he's still pushing so very hard. Quite amazing stuff.
You must wonder, though, actually, how far he's willing to push these soft tires, because I'm not entirely sure of the sort of distances that people can go on the soft tires, but surely all of this battling pushing is going to be damaging them anyway. Up at the front, however,
pits.
Yeah, Mashuli and Columbus pit. So it's battle of the pit crews here. Columbus had gained a lot on Mashuli in that last thing. Mashuli leaves now. Here goes Columbus. Gaia and Fider both going through, by the way. Mashuli back out into third. Columbus back out into fourth, and comfortably into fourth as well.
I think
it might be said.
I think you got the answer about the how long the self tires can last. If our race leader, who's doing quite good lap times all around, can last for 40% of the race, 22 laps, I think we're pretty much fine with just one more pit stop for Francesconi. And if he can just put out those lap times, I think he'll be fine.
You know what? Francesconi is probably going to be in the best position of anyone at the end of the race, because everyone else, barring Lopez, mind you, who's just clattered the Retafilio once again, they're going to have to be on the hard tire, whereas Lopez and Francesconi, mired in that midfield at the moment, are going to be on the softer compound tire. So I don't know. I mean, let's say it's what, lap 23? So we'll say they go on to the hard tire on lap 44 or something. That's still going to be about 9 laps of hard tire running.
Yes.
The soft tire guy is going to be at a massive advantage for those 9 laps, though.
Yes, yeah, about a second and a half to 2 seconds a lap. That's quite big. As interestingly enough, Ben Horrell does the quickest first sector of anyone throughout this race.
Ben Horrell?
Yes.
And he's still lagging massively, actually. I'd be very worried if I was Tobias Olsen, to be honest, because he's all over the place, unfortunately.
Yes, it seems to have fixed itself currently, but that could just come back any second.
And yeah, actually, to be fair, Ben is really motoring a lot. Oh, well, there we go. Off.
Yep.
Oh, as I say, I would not want to be in Olsen's shoes. In fact, I would probably let him by if I was Olsen. But
at
you know what?
At this point, yes.
He's still actually ahead, and it looks like Horrell hasn't tried for a move just yet. But look how much he closes there, as apparently he wants to move here with DeVos.
DeVos is closing on Frenchies at the moment.
DeVos is closing on Frenchies, but more importantly, Ben Horrell is getting past Tobias Olsen here.
Fran Lopez's engine!
Fran Lopez's engine has gone. That is an engine blowout. Is that the first one we've seen all season? I'm not entirely sure.
I see what happened, and I have no idea how he did it. So
did he go straight to neutral or something?
He put it into neutral about at around the pit exit, and then suddenly he puts it into first gear from 8. And blows the engine instantly.
That
it looked
is
like
a
hate shifter. It looked like a hate shifter failure, or possibly just accidentally put the car into neutral and then press shift up to get it back up and running, but he forgot to clutch it and killed the engine that way. That's over and done.
Both red arches out then. Their dire campaign goes from bad to worse. Fran Lopez becomes our 5th retirement of the day. So Ben Horrell benefits. Does Ben Horrell benefit? Hold on. Oh, no, that's because I'm on delay. Never mind. Ben Horrell up to P9. Very worried there. Tobias Olsen up to P10. And basically everyone else getting position. In fact, the only person not currently in a point-scoring position is Naranjan Kumar. One more retirement. And anybody who finishes 90% of the Grand Prix will be scoring. Shout out to Vodball team boss Mike Pittman, who texts in. Rightly pointing out, Vodball are not the reigning champions. That is CSG Racing, I believe. So, great job from me there. Philip Pushko is the reigning champion. Don't worry. But he says that I'm expecting both Nordschans to try a one-stop as they are worried about the lack of power. I would not be surprised, especially as both of them are still out there on lap 25 of 53 here.
But that would be such a risk with the slower tire as well.
Well, they're certainly going to be doing the longest stint of the harder tires, that's for certain.
I wouldn't be that certain considering they're 24 laps in. Well, 25 laps complete now. And that's, what is it, 48, 49% of the... No, 47%. But still, having that many laps already on the soft tire, they may actually drive longer on the soft tire and then the harder tire just there for as short as they can, even if it's to a single stop.
That is the beauty of Monza, isn't it? It is, if not one of, definitely the least degrading tire tracks that you can find. As you rightly said earlier in the broadcast, actually, not a lot of fast corners. In fact, the only one that really constitutes a fast corner, I guess, is Ascari, maybe?
And Lesmo.
And the Lesmo's at a stretch, so...
Yeah.
We will wait and see whether the Nordschans are going to attempt one stop here. If they were both to pit now, they would be, I'd say, third and fourth. Fyduk, actually, might come out behind Francis and DeVos here, but that is all going to depend on just how much these two battle, because as Menno correctly pointed out earlier, DeVos was catching ever so slightly, and now he is right on the back of the Croatian. The Belgian quite eager to get that top five back.
Yeah, he'll definitely want to get that top five back again, and I think he stands in with a chance that Carreño, ever since they got the podium for the first time in many years, back in Austria, if I recall correctly, they've just had wings basically attached to the cars, I think.
As we've got a double stack pit stop going on here, Gaia in, Fydek in. Is this a bit too close to call, I wonder? If Fydek wasn't going to finish up behind... Oh
wow, so
that
close.
That is beautifully executed from Nordschen there. Florian Gaia back on the road in P3. What about Fydek though? Here comes Francis and DeVos, and indeed the two of them do jump. David Fydek, so the 2014 champion, down to P6. He can't exactly let up either because Emmanuel Gascella is there. But Mike Pittman, you absolutely called it. The two of them onto the hard tires. We're presuming no more pit stops until the end of the race. So actually, they could still benefit from later pit stops from everyone. But whether that will be good or bad long term with losing a second and a half per lap, certainly to be debated for now.
I think they're going to not benefit from it really at all in the end. By the way, Eros Mashuli just putting in some world of hurt on everyone now with 126 flats, which are just record after record again. So this time around, the other Adonis car just doing the exact same thing.
Columbus is still keeping touch though. 5.5 seconds. The gap certainly come down from that earlier issue that he had across the Della Rogge. So yeah, I still think Columbus is still in with a chance of winning this race, of course. And we've certainly got to see how good the two of them are on the hard tire, of course. And indeed, when they pit, if someone attempts to do the undercut.
Also, couple things. Just looking at top speeds of the cars. Do you want to hear the absolutely crazy top speed that Columbus had after that battle?
Hit me.
361.3 kilometers an hour in a straight line.
These cars are fast.
They are. Very.
Some might say that they are the fastest of the career ladder.
Well, that's... You know, that's debatable. No.
Yeah.
No, it's not. These cars are so very quick. Again, they're Formula One cars. What else do you expect?
Absolutely, yeah. I think we will keep a little beady eye on our P4 battle here. Francis still under a lot of pressure from DeVos, though I think I saw a bit of a position change. Yes, that's it. Lewis Redshaw is just going around the outside of Tobias Olsen there at turn one. So Olsen, who, by the way, is still doing a fantastic job there in P11 for Nijo, just losing out there to Lewis Redshaw back into the top 10 in Englishman. 6 seconds up the road, though, is Ben Horrell. So debating whether the Woods driver is going to make any further progress from here. As for Tobias, just keep on doing what you're doing, putting the consistent laps. You're scoring good points for your outfit here. But then back to Francis DeVos. We can see that DeVos is clearly within a second of Francis, so he's going to get the DRS. But I do wonder whether that Kernow is going to have the same sort of problem as Columbus was having on Gaia back at the start of the race, whether the DRS is just, it's helping, but it's not enough.
I think the DRS really in this track is not very big, just because of such a low downforce that's being run here in most cars. Also, by the way, Bart DeVos, another thing that Menno has pointed out to me, he's driving for Kernow. He's the only Kernow left in the field currently. And their team is only 3 points in front of Woods Racing, who is not having as good of a race as Bart. So he really wants to extend that lead currently.
Yeah, so Bart was currently scoring 11 points in fifth. Woods collectively scoring 10 points from a 10th and a 12th. That is now up to 11 points, though, because Tobias Olsen has come in for his second pit stop. Onto the hard tire he goes. This is probably going to be Tobias's last stop of the race. So Schroten's still technically in 12th. But Tobias, that early soft tire pit stop, it's gained him a little bit, I think. But now comes the long slog onto the hard tire.
Yes, so that long drive on the hard tire is going to feel like an eternity at this point. And let's see some of the times that we're seeing from the Nordstrom. And you know what? They're not actually nearly as bad as I thought they would be. Florian Geyer is only about half a second slower than Mashulia Lapp. That's actually quite impressive.
And this is speaking a lot. You remember when I was saying that the gap between Mashulia and Columbus was 5.5? Yeah, now it's 7 seconds. So it's not like Mashulia is holding about at all. You know, Geyer is absolutely going for it, but
oh, wait.
I still bring you back to this point. Franjic and DeVos are still closing on Geyer.
Yes, so, this lap around, he was a second slower than Mashulia, but only half a second slower than Columbus. It's still impressive considering what tires they're running on.
Yeah, absolutely. Well, I mean, it is all about damage limitation, and then they're not pitting again. We do have to keep this in mind. So, as it stands, Florian Geyer would actually take the lead of the race at a later point in the Grand Prix, as it stands.
Yes, and he will be on the same compound as everyone around him, but on a compound that's also much older.
Like 20 laps older by that point.
Yes, which will be quite a big difference.
But then again, I mean, the soft tires lasted 24 laps or so for the Norgians.
Yes, but that's the last thing, not exactly performance per se, so you can't really judge it in that way.
Considering
he was about a second and a half, by the end he was about a second and a half slower, Mashulia was, compared to his teammate. So, yeah, I think it very much... the tires do degrade in pace quite a bit by the end of a 20-lap stint.
Well, I've just had a little look down the field, and I'd say that this battle for P4, 5, and the closing on P3 is actually the most exciting thing going on track, unfortunately, with only 16 cars running.
One battle going, kind of, for the very last points place between Hinz and Kumar. That's Francesconi in pits, by the way.
I was just about to go on to that, and so this is Francesconi's last stop then, which is about right. He pits on lap 31, so about, 22, 23 laps on the softs to go. He comes out behind Lewis Redshaw, who still has yet to pit onto the hard tire, so he should take back that position easily, but now is arguably the most important stint for Francesconi. He's got to make these early laps on the soft tire count to gain even more into the gaps which are ahead of him.
Yes, but he doesn't want to kill those tires either way. The advantage he has currently is that he has the fresher tires than anyone in front of him. He is on the same compound as most drivers around him. And the only problem he has is he has to make them last for 23 laps. So I think he's going to be able to do it, but by the end his pace is going to be quite degraded.
Wait and see. I mean, I'm, I was interested in looking back at this battle for P15 actually, which is pretty hot. It's hotting up quite nicely, even more so because we now have our race leader Eros Mashuli catching up to these guys, and that's some good backmarking there from Kumar getting out of the way nice and early on the exit at Delarogier. So Hinz is going to get a bit of a reprieve here as we head through the two Lesmos. He doesn't want to hold up Eros Mashuli for too long, as I think I possibly disconnected from the server. So could you please keep commentating, Kacper?
Mashuli goes by quite easily. Actually, Hinz just slightly slows down before Ascari. But now that means that Kumar did catch up quite a bit as Hinz makes a bit of a mistake going to Ascari. Nothing big, but just a bit of a wiggle, which does allow Kumar to get in within about four car lengths. So we'll see how that goes, but it seems like it could be a very interesting battle, and the only one really we can get... Wait, never mind. Did Francis just pass the Voss on track?
I don't know, because I lost connection. At the worst time, I know. But
yes,
if the Voss is back, if the Voss is ahead of Francis, then yes, that was on track.
Francis is in front of the Voss, who just made... Yeah! Oh my god, what? Oh, DeVos kind of crashed with Francic in the second chicane, turned Francic around, and DeVos is in seventh place, Francic is in sixth, so Fidok and Gasella actually got positions from that.
Who would you say is more at fault there? Was it someone turning in on the other, or was it?
I think it was more. I'm not entirely sure. It was a bit jumpy just on the basis that it was so far back in the replay, but it seemed more like a racing incident than anything. I wouldn't be the one to judge at the very least.
Either way, Fajduk, Gashela both benefit massively from that. I'd say Fajduk more than anyone else, because now that's another two people behind him who have to pit once again. So actually, a Fajduk podium looking more and more likely.
Yes, very much. I mean, Geyer is still there, his teammate. So that's one thing, but he does look fairly good for that. Also, holy... Yes, Francesconi just had the quickest lap of the race. Just a stroll, half a second faster than anyone else during this entire race.
Man is on a mission after getting past Lewis Redshaw.
Yes, he had the quickest second and third sector of anyone during this race. And the first sector was slower than the record just set by someone else, I think Horrell, by 0.05 of a second. So the man is on a mission indeed.
Right, Baldi has been in and out. Soft tire. And you'd be interested to hear that Olsen has also been in and out again. I don't know why, though. He's back out onto the hard tire. So I can only presume that that might have been for either a drive-through or he damaged his car in some way. Baldi back into P13, Olsen into P14.
Yeah, it very much looks like more than anything, maybe like a speeding penalty or something. But wouldn't you have to actually serve that earlier on? I'm not entirely sure. Very odd.
His lap was a 1:32.0.
As Baldi and Michuli go side by side for Ascari. But Baldi just taking that place from Michuli.
Despite the fact that Michuli is lapping them?
Or is it the Baldi and...
Oh, Michelis.
Yes, yes. No, not Michuli.
I was like, Michulis, what?
Yes, or... I'm not. I'm sorry. Lithuanian... Is it names?
Huh?
Is Davida...
Davidas Michulis.
Michulis, right.
Lithuanian,
yes, yeah. Yes. Yeah, I have absolutely no idea how to pronounce the Lithuanian names. They're quite, yes. Always, a bit of a mystery to me.
As are Polish and Irish names to me, but I...
yeah.
Can't win them all, unfortunately.
Can't.
As I should mention again, I mean, you remember story time with James again. You remember a few laps ago when I said that the gap between Michuli and Columbus was about 6 seconds or so? Yeah, it's now 8.1 seconds. Italian just, you know, pounding home more and more dominance. He really wants this third race win of the season.
Just tires again. He's powering through, but he's also being allowed to do that because of the tires he's on. He's on a much faster compound. And that is exactly why everyone tries to avoid this exact tire compound as much as they can. It's just not quick enough.
I should ask as well, just out of pure interest, if Michuli was to win, of course, he'd be winning his home Grand Prix. Is there?
Yes.
Is there almost like a natural lift whenever you take part in a home race? I realize that some people actually despise their home tracks, yet you're still technically racing in your home country. So there's almost something like, oh, I've got to do well here, you know, just to say, oh, I'm this countryman and I'm going to be doing well in my country.
I think there's more of a pressure on that in real life, where you have people around actually cheering for you every time you go by. You have, you know, you have this kind of feeling of nearly a massive family around you, possibly. But in sim racing, it's more of a symbolic, more than anything else, just status more than anything. And of course, it's going to be nice. And the one thing that's true would be, you know, you're from this country, you know this track probably in and out just because you've grown up in that country and you've always been looking into those. I mean, Monza, who doesn't know the Temple of Speed?
My mother.
Oh, brother. Well, anyone racing, okay? Anyone interested in racing?
I should mention Gashela here and Horrell have both pitted for the hard tire or the hard compound. Actually, hold on. Ben Horrell's not on the hard compound tire. He's on the soft compound tire. So Odd one there from Ben, and he's gone completely off track as well. He cuts the white line on the inside. I'm not sure whether that's legal or not, but he has done it anyways. Oh, Gogo Baldi's been off the road at Ascari, and that is a very damaged Wouters automotive car. And that has allowed Niranjan Kumar on his debut for Hawkeye into the point. Is this the Indians' lucky day?
I think it may as well be at this point. It's going to be quite a bit of damage repair for Baldi at this point, and it's going to take a while. If he can even get there without crashing and taking off a wheel.
Stay on the inside, Gergo, please. That's a good idea, using the inside of the track to your advantage. I'm hoping nobody else has to pit behind him. Thankfully not, as Misoulis has also been in and out of the pit. He's onto the hard tyre, now running in 15th place. So Kumar up to 14th. I think he still has to pit again, though. So it's still a win for Kumar. He can say he's been in 14th place, at least in the Super League. Back on tyre watch, by the way, in terms of this Nordschen strategy. If Columbus and Masuli were to pit now, Gaia would still be in the lead. But only 5 seconds, give or take, though.
Just something interesting. Masciulli in the lead currently. His last lap was slower than Columbus. And so, yeah, that gap has gone down to 7.5 seconds currently. And he's still lapping slower. The first 2 sectors of this lap were slower than Columbus once again. So kind of interesting to see that Columbus having a bit more pace currently.
Maybe Masciulli finally deciding to keep a hold of the tires.
Maybe. He still has the pits, of course, for the prime tires, but he probably does kind of want to just finish as far as he can on these tires and then just do a couple laps on the hard tires.
Pitting for prime tires is exactly what Lewis Redshaw has just done. He's been in and out and back on the road in P11, the Englishman. Good to see Gogo Baldi, by the way, still going around. He's P16. He really does need a retirement now, though, in order to score a point for Wouters Automotive. David Franjic and Bart De Vos still battling away. They're still within a second of each other. They've got entangled already. Hopefully now that it's round two, we won't see the same sort of contact. But I reckon these guys are going to be battling through the pits as well. And if I was Bart De Vos, I'd probably seriously question whether I shouldn't try the undercut on Franjic.
That'd be very interesting, but I don't think that's going to... Undercut only really works if you're going on the faster tire. So if you're going onto the slower tire, I don't think that's going to really work very well, as he is so very close behind Franjic now.
Oh yeah, that was a really bad chicane from Franjic. Bart De Vos just tucking up under, being nice and sensible, as that is a position change. Roy Schroten coming into the pits for his final stop of the day. And Bart De Vos really close to David Franjic now, tucked up there, opens the DRS zone. That's where it is.
Yes.
Finally found out. Down the inside of Ascari we go, and Bart De Vos is through into P5, although for how long? He didn't exactly take Ascari like a champ, and now David Franjic's got all of the slipstream of this back straight and all of the slipstream of the front straight to get back through.
That's such a battle, and just to give you the idea of the top speeds of these two cars and the difference between the setups they must be driving in, the top speed I'm seeing for Bart De Vos throughout this race was at 352 kilometers an hour, while Franjic is 357, 5 kilometers an hour difference, and I think that's exactly what's happening here.
Easy as pie, a pizza pie, you might say, here in Italy. David Franjic, I wonder whether Bart De Vos will consider overtaking him at Ascari again, especially if that's just going to happen.
As we have Emmanuel Gazzella in pits.
Gazzella for his final pit stop then. De Vos, by the way, look at that. Franjic has taken that chicane terribly again. So Bart De Vos right onto the back of Franjic as we head into a Lesmo 1. Really difficult corner, that one, where you have to try and hug the apex as close as possible, and you have to wait longer than you really want before getting on the power. It's the same case with Lesmo 2, albeit a bit shorter. Here comes the DRS for Bart De Vos once again, though. Down the straight towards Ascari. He decides to go to the outside this time.
He's got it.
Was that a bit of contact there as well, I think?
No, I think it was completely clean. Franjic just tried to avoid contact, but De Vos just able to power through. And I think he's got enough of a lead now to just get to Parabolico unchallenged. For once.
Yeah, that was That was really smart from De Bossi. Actually, Francis went really defensive a bit too early, called his line, when arguably it would have been better for De Bossi to go down the outside and get Ascari all wrong. We'll see whether Francis can respond once again. Now he's got the DRS.
If I was De Bossi, I would be going on the inside and trying to defend that part of the circuit. But Francis has not been bad. Yes, Francis is not close enough to being able to do that. So finally, Bart De Bossi getting a bit more of a breather.
Up into P5 then.
Very well done.
How much further can you go? Remember, these two still need to pit, however, for the harder compound tyre. So there's still a bit of strategy and play still to work its way out here. It's lap 40 of 53. As we're hearing, Gergo Baldi has lost yet another wing on that car. It seems like he's, coming into the pits once again. The Hungarian not having a good race at all. I do wonder whether he's going to consider calling it a day here. Indeed he is. So out of the race goes Gergo Baldi with suspension damage. Our sixth retirement of the day. For everyone else, as long as they make it to... let's get this correct. As long as they make it to lap 48, they'll be scoring points.
Not too far to go. 8 laps for the leaders.
But there's all so much that can go wrong at the same time.
There could be. Anything can happen in racing. Mm. And now that we have a bit more of gaps, now it's going to be difficult to find a battle.
Partially created by the fact that David Francis is coming to the pits here.
Yes, but I think now that he did get overtaken by Bart De Vos, he wasn't able to quite keep up.
Look at Francesconi! He's overtaken David Francis in the pits, and you know what? I bet you he's going to overtake Bart De Vos as well. So Francesconi looking at P5. From the back of the... from the back of the grid. From pit lane.
You know what? It depends on what happens to Fidok, but... actually, I wonder, what's the pace of Francesconi compared to Fidok at this point? It's a second and 4/10 quicker lap. Now, can he catch up?
I'm going to do some calculations. It's quick math, James, to return. 1.4 seconds. There's what? 12 laps to go?
Yes.
So that would make 16.8 seconds gain for Francesconi, which would put him... At 20 seconds, you know what? I think he might actually be able to get Fidok. If the pace remains the same, he can get Fidok.
He can just about catch up and possibly overtake. We'll see by the end, of course, because the tires will be completely dead by the end, basically.
So it
depends on how much he can keep, how much of the thread he can keep on those tires by the end, basically. But wow.
Fascinating end to the race ahead of us, though.
And yeah, especially it's gonna be
considering very good. That we're going to have. We're going to have the lead as well with Masciulli, Columbus, and Geyer. Although that said, it seems like the reason why Masciulli and Columbus are staying out as long as they are at the moment is purely to try and get ahead of Geyer. Gap between Masciulli and Geyer now 20 seconds. So Masciulli, if he's able to keep up this pace, might just be able to pit and get away ahead of Geyer. Won't be the same for Columbus, I don't think. He's going to have a bit of a job on his hands to take second away from Florian. But Masciulli working very nicely and could have a pit stop in hand here.
Yeah, at this point I'm looking and Columbus is doing quicker laps than Masciulli is. So, and he's actually beating his own record lap times at the moment. So Columbus on a mission himself. But yeah... In general, this track actually on tire-wise, it's kind of interesting. I remember at one point, it was just some leaderboard stuff, I think in Assetto Corsa or something, on this very track. And I remember GT3 cars were actually quicker on medium tires than on the softs, just on the basis that this track is what it is. It doesn't need that much, lateral grip? I'm not even sure what it was, but it was very funny. And obviously it's not very much the case here with the soft tires being a lot quicker still, but if anything, this would be the track with the least difference between the two.
We've got an exciting battle at the end of the pit lane here, sorry. Niranjan Kumar has just come in for his final stop, the Indian. Just going to get up to speed now, and he is going to come out ahead of Thomas Hinz. But the battle for the final points resumes now with Hinz breaking into turn one, about a second behind the Indian. I think it's great to see these two scoring points here. It just goes to show, if you are able to keep it on track, if you're able to stay consistent, you're always in with a chance of scoring.
Of course, and again, consistently finishing, that's the most important in racing, and especially in a league like this where the cars are very difficult to, well, they're not difficult to drive per se, but they're very difficult to push for the entirety of the stint and the entirety of the race.
You might say that they are not so hard to learn, but very difficult to master.
Yes, they are, and I'd say from my experience of trying to just drive around in this, oh, as Hinz just makes a bit of a mistake. And we have Horrell with... Oh no. Either way.
I think Ben Horrell spun.
It seems like Ben Horrell spun at one point, but I'm not seeing it currently.
What is more important, however, here is Bart DeVos. He's just pitted. Francesconi confirmed through to P5. But where is DeVos in comparison to Francesconi? Because remember, DeVos was on the soft tire, so he's gone a lot longer here. Here comes Francesconi. DeVos out the pit lane. This is going to be mightily close, you know, going down into turn one. Here comes Francesconi now. It's going to be much closer than Hinz versus Kumar. Into the braking zone we go. And DeVos just about covers off Francesconi there. Battle is very much resumed on this front, though, for the what is ultimately going to be P6.
But now Francesconi has the tires that are already a lap old, so possibly just a bit more up to spec of what the car likes. So he is about to attack on the outside. And not quite able to do it, as we actually have the leader in pits.
Yep. I don't think he's going to clear Gaia. Not as it stands, anyway. I think the guy is going to lead this race, if only briefly. And this might actually damage Mishuli's race. We'll see where... Columbus is actually going around for another lap as well, so this might be important. Mishuli onto the hard tyre. And, yeah, Gaia goes through into P2. And this is for position, by the way. Mishuli will have to overtake Gaia on track, although he makes a terrible mess of it into the chicane, Gaia. He's going to have to overtake Florian naturally on track to take that P2 away from him.
From what I'm seeing now for Gaia is that he's also struggling on the exits of corners as well, very much just not quite able to get the traction required. So the tires are showing their age at this point. But
let's keep this very clear to our audience, though. If things... It's what, lap 45 of 53? Yes. Gaia is in with a chance of winning this race.
He is. He's very much with a chance. Well, he does have Mishuli on the back of him. Mm. And Mishuli has shown that he is extremely quick on anything on this track today, at the very least. But Gaia, if he can just hold off the attacks from Mishuli, who's on the same compound of tires, he is very much with a chance of winning.
Because, of course, Columbus was 7 seconds behind Mishuli, so he's going to pit. And from looking at the times, he is going to come out ahead of Fiduk, so he is going to be on the podium. But third place seems to me, at current time at least, the maximum he's going to get, which, fair play to Norwegian, they have played this wonderfully.
Let's be honest, if they actually come out with a win here, that's going to be a hero story, especially with the engine, with those engines being at 50%.
He is really struggling into the braking zones, Gaia. That's the second time that he's messed up the retrofilia chicane. Is the gap between the two? 1.9 seconds, and that was when they crossed the line, not after sector one. We'll get a better idea of how close the two of them are now. 1.4 seconds, so... Mishuli is the oncoming storm for Florian Gaia here. Will he blitzkrieg his way to victory, or is the Italian going to start a revolution?
I think at this point, Mishuli, unless Gaia has some widening tricks or pulls a Verstappen somewhere, which we don't want to see.
No, absolutely not, no.
I think Mishuli is in for a win here if he can just get past.
I mean, yeah, you can see those tires are what, about 15 to 20 laps old, so... Oh, but Mishuli going off the track there in an attempt to try and gain some time on Gaia.
But it seems like that only slowed him down a little bit.
Yeah, I think it's been a valiant effort for Norchin, and they have played the strategy perfectly, but a race win might be a bit out of the question here.
Let's be honest, though. Second place and what it looks like, fourth place. That could be amazing result nonetheless.
I mean, especially considering the engines and all that, it'd be an outstanding result. Gets the chicane good there, but you can see there visibly how much better Mashuli was on the brakes, and now he's tucked up right into the slipstream of Florian Geyer here. This for the net lead. Mindaugas Klumbers still yet to pit. I think he's just trying to gain time on Geyer on the soft tire, but Geyer there into the De La Rogier, still ahead of Mashuli, holding him up just a little bit. This might yet affect the race somewhat, as Geyer, you know what, I would not hold Mashuli up at this point, because surely he wants to gain as much time on Klumbers as possible.
Yeah, but I mean, they're fighting. Mashuli will have to get by.
They are fighting for the lead, yeah.
They're not the same. They're not from the same team anyway, even if even if they were.
I'm just thinking strategy-wise, as I say, I mean, does Geyer really think he's going to hold off Mashuli for the next six laps?
Well, you never know, really. We've seen crazier stuff happening in real life as well.
The very fair point that you put there. Into the parabolica we go. And Mashuli staying behind literally just enough to get a good exit out here and attempt to utilize the DRS zone down to turn one. He tucks up once again. Wing open. But then again, look at Geyer and that Nordschirm power. Able to stay ahead into turn one, where he nailed the chicane. Looks like he's gotten his braking sorted finally.
That is, of course, also a bit of a rare sight to see two different engines fighting, as we have Mashuli just so very close behind Geyer now.
It's the traction. Mashuli was like a horse out of the blocks on that one, and around the outside he's going to have to try the De La Rozier chicane, although Geyer runs him off the road very slightly, and Mashuli's going to go round the edge of the De La Rozier there. Interesting. I mean, I'm going to have a little look here, see whether Mashuli did have enough room on track. It looks like he attempted to brake later where there was no room. So it was hard defending from Geyer, but it was also fair defending.
Yeah, it looked fair enough to me. It was just about a car width left, and that's all you really need to do.
As I say, Mashuli wasn't even alongside Geyer when he came over a little bit. So that was Mashuli's choice to brake a little later and try and go for the gap.
Yeah, of course, we also see that the used tires don't have nearly as good stopping distance there.
No.
Yes, that's one of the reasons you, of course, don't want to drive on these tires for very long. They just lose all of their characteristics.
Either way, it's another lap to tick off for Florian Geyer, as Mindaugas Klumbers still driving there in P1, lap 49 of 53. He has been on those soft tires an awfully long time, but he is going to have to pit eventually onto the hards.
But you know what? He's actually gaining time on Mashuli and Geyer currently.
He is, because they're battling with each other.
Yes, he's gaining about a second last lap.
That's understandable.
Yes.
But this is fascinating. What a great end to the race we have here. Do stay tuned.
I think with the way that they planned out the race, Norsen car is set up for a straight is a far better option than if they set it up like the Adonis car is, slightly more for the corners, so that they knew that even if they had to defend, they had the upper hand.
Here comes Mashuli, though. He's going to have DRS into the Ascari chicane here. Will he look down the inside, the Italian? I think he might have a little cheeky dive. Yes, he is. He brakes very late there, the Italian.
Not
in fact,
able to
he goes
it.
Off the circuit. And Florian Geyer drives straight around the outside. Oh, he's getting frustrated, Eros. And he's making mistakes which he doesn't need to make.
As Mindaugas pits.
Klumbers pits. 16 seconds between himself and Geyer. So he is going to come out in third position, about 4 seconds off the lead to him. But Florian Geyer is driving an incredible, outstanding, inspired race. Lap 50 of 53, 4 to go. Can the German win his first Grand Prix?
I'm nearly rooting for him currently. He's just, oh wow, this is quite an amazing job he's doing. To hold off Mashuli in this kind of fashion and just not give in to the stress is quite amazing.
Right, Mindaugas is at the start of the Curva Grande. That is your reference here as Mashuli once again right on the back of Guy. He's going to go and dive down for the De La Rosier chicane. Oh, and he's lost him at the braking. Oh, massive spin. He did make another mistake, and actually Gaia went off in sympathy. So all advantage that he's won is now lost. And here comes Columbus as well. Mashuli's mistake has simultaneously brought Gaia off the road and brought Columbus into the lead context here. Right on the back of the Italian now. Stay where you are. We have a finish on our hands.
What in the world has just happened? I am speechless. Like, this is one of the craziest endings of a race I've seen in a very long time.
And Columbus has got the freshest tires as well. He's only 2.1 seconds off the lead, and he's going to tuck up now into the slipstream of Eros Mashuli. He had the race win in his hands. All he had to do was be patient, but he was too eager, too naive. And he is now not only under pressure for the race win, but under pressure for second place. I mean, Daugas Columbus, a Lithuanian, comes around the final corner now. We'll have DRS on this lap, but is it going to be effective enough? It's been a big question mark over a lot of the field this race. And I noticed Horrell and Gashella going into battle slower down the field, but this is a much more important battle as Eros gets the chicane horribly wrong. The two of them are holding themselves up massively. Gaia will be laughing in his cockpit, but more importantly, Mindaugas Columbus makes the move stick. He is through to P2 Eros. Oh, it's all falling away from him, isn't it? He's going to dive down on the De La Rosier, is he? No, he's going to be a little bit more careful this time. Columbus up to P2.
I honestly think that the spin he did, he basically had happened last time he attacked. That spin also damaged his tires, I'd say, since in R-Factor 2, it's so easy to do so. And once you're spinning, you just have so much friction in the flat spots as well. It must be so insane in that car currently.
Oh, wow. By the looks of Columbus pulling away, Eros Mashuli is out of the win, out of the winning potential here, I guess. There's a much better way of saying that. But either way, at the end of this lap, we will be on lap 52 or 53, penultimate lap. We'll keep a very close eye on the times here. Florian Gaia rounds the Parabolica. Remember, he is fighting for his first ever Grand Prix win here at GPVWC. He goes on to lap 52. Mindaugas Columbus, 1.8 seconds to make up in two laps. It's going to be a last lap lunge, isn't it, if there's ever going to be a move. Eros Mashuli, he's not really lost too much touch from Columbus, and still could prove a big factor in this race if the front two were to get mixed up.
If there's one driver who could make it in one car and could do it in a lunge, but at the end, due to his top speed, would be Columbus, who has a 10 km/h advantage on a straight.
1.5 seconds between Geyer and Columbus. He took 3 seconds out of the German in that one sector alone.
But Columbus just made a bit of a mistake coming out of the second chicane.
I think those mistakes are actually counteracted by the fact that Geyer is so slow at this point. I mean, look how fast he is catching up. It is so visible to me on the screen that I am watching as we head down to Ascari. You are not going anywhere, audience. This is going to be a fantastic finish to this race. Into Ascari we go. 1.2 seconds between Gaia and Columbus. And you know what? He might very well be in DRS zone of Gaia by the time we hit. By the time we hit the home straight here, we could have DRS zone for Columbus on Gaia. And wasn't this the major thing? DRS zones causing issues. And it was Columbus on Gaia, wasn't it? That was the major move, which took so long. It's a repeat of that battle, which we saw so early on. We crossed the start finish line. Final lap. 0.5 between Gaia and Columbus. This is going to be close. There's not going to be enough of an overlap for Columbus to even attempt anything into turn one. But for Ascari, for example, for Parabolica, there's going to be plenty of opportunity. Look at the drive from Mindaugas Columbus off that front corner of that second turn. Gaia is struggling. He's driving his socks off. And oh my word, going into the De La Rosier chicane. Will Columbus have a look? This is for the race win. Oh, is he going to have a little dive? Oh, he's broken a little late there. Oh. He's putting... Oh, he's
made a mistake.
No, he's made a mistake. Oh my word. Has this gifted Gaia the win? Oh, Mindaugas.
I think it just did.
Oh my word, he's still got a bit of... We've still got half a lap to go. Stay with us, still half a lap to go. There's every chance that Gaia could make a mistake. Look at Lewis, is that Roy Schroten up ahead? Yes, it is. Lapped traffic. We've seen it before, ladies and gentlemen. Lap traffic always seems to cause an issue. Going into Ascari, Florian Geyer, oh, he's so tentative, isn't he? He just wants to get it round. I think he might have made it. It's just one turn left. One turn left for Florian Geyer. Towards Parabolica we go. Mindaugas Clubmis has closed the gap to 1.2 seconds again. Into Parabolica. We head with Florian Geyer. All he's got to do is keep it on track. Look how conservative he is, not even pushing. He rounds the final corner. He takes the checkered flag for Norton Racing on a damaged engine. Florian Geyer wins his first Grand Prix. Mindaugas Clubmis second. Eros Mashuli from such a comfortable position takes home the final podium position. David Fyerdyk again on a very weak engine, P4. Great driving from both Nordschen cars. Francesconi P5. Bart De Vos will take home P6 with David Franchich P7. Ben Horrell will take home P8 with Lewis Redshaw P9. And oh yeah, Emmanuel Gascella getting into all sorts of trouble there. I think he's had a bit of trouble, hasn't he? And in fact, he's going to lose P10 here to Roy Schroten on the final lap. So Roy Schroten will take home P10, Emmanuel Gascella P11. Tobias Olsen takes home P12 with Davidas Masoulis P13. Good points there for Nijo. Narendran Kumar on his debut, P14 for Hawkeye. They will be delighted with that. And Thomas Hinz will take home the final point in P15.
Yes, that's crazy, because Schroten actually could have very easy. He was just in front of Geyer as they crossed the line, so he could have very easily just given into blue flags. That's Gascella, what is happening?
He's lost his front wing, hasn't he? I wonder whether he's had a... Actually, no, he hasn't. Wonder whether it's the tyres have gone, maybe.
I'm not sure, he couldn't shift out.
We can speculate either way. Your retirements from this race: Baldy, Lopez, McNaughton, Brewer, Parker and Benefield. But for Florian Geyer, what a race and a half he has just pulled off. Weakened engine.
I think that's...
One stop. Hard tyres, 20 laps old by the end. And he's just taken his first Grand Prix win.
Amazing, amazing stuff. I think this must be probably the best race I've ever watched, really, in sim racing, just with so much action and pretty much all of it clean. Just wow, that's amazing. That's just amazing stuff.
And Francesconi from the pit lane to fifth, an outstanding job from him as well.
Yes,
drivers' championship. Fyerdyk now leads on 197. Mashuli second on 195, 2 points behind him. And Pushka only 11 points away in P3. So the Drivers' Championship, still massive ebb and flow. I'm just working out the Constructors' Championship. But for Fyerdyk, it's another swing his way. Obviously, getting back on top of the championship is a big confidence boost.
Oh, for sure. That's a big confidence boost after he lost it last round, yeah. So, yeah, just one round to have to drive as a second man.
Bonus for Guy, well-deserved as well, to be fair. Why not?
Very much. I mean, you may as well kill the tires now. They probably had like 10% left by the end.
And the engine. I mean, the engine's dead already, so... The team is half Italian. They go by a Norwegian flag these days, but they are half Italian, and they're Welsh, Italian, and Norwegian. But either way, that's going to be a very popular win in the paddock as well, I imagine.
Oh yes, I think they showed that the one time that these tires worked. I don't think I've seen it in the races I've commentated on so far. Ever anyone making these tires work like they did? That's amazing stuff from Norsen. Just very well done on all fronts.
And just to confirm, the constructors here, Adonis Dill still do lead on 347, but Norsen have closed the gap significantly. Only 17 points behind now on 330. Vodbol, they had a driver on the podium, but Franchich, he was solid, but not exactly Pushka solid. 314 points for them. So
user joined your channel.
Both championship still
user joined your channel.
Very, very open. And there's still plenty of rounds to go as well. That just goes to show how amazing the Super League can go on its day. And speaking of amazing, we've got our number one driver here today, Florian Geyer. First Grand Prix win. how on earth does that feel?
Oh man, it's pretty amazing. Lost for words, to be honest.
I mean, it's considering as well, like, you had a weakened engine, you had a one-stop strategy to try and pull off on the weaker tire for pretty much the majority of the race, and yet it just all seemed to fall at your lap.
Well, I kind of think that the whole team, Will and Dave, first of all, because Dave came up with the idea for one stop, and we pretty much agreed on it during testing. It seemed like the fastest way for us. And I think the front row start pretty much was the key to this. I didn't lose any time during the race. And in the end, the pressure was enormous from Eros and Winnegas. I mean, both right behind me, one mistake. I made a few to turn one. But I don't know, man. It's just great to finally have done it all these years. I mean, the last time I won was Super Cup 2 years ago. And all the hard work we've done, I think nobody would have guessed. With our form lately, that we could win this one and actually have better tire wear or strategy than the other guys.
It's funny that you mentioned Super Cup as well. I remember your last win well, and I remember just you in that Super Cup campaign as well with Simcroft. You were the tire gods. You could make them last longer than anyone else, and I realize it's not exactly the same sort of situation here, yet you made a one-stop work. And it's gifted you a win, and to further compile that good feeling, you're now only 17 points away from Adonis Engineering. So, we've got 4 rounds left. Can Nordschen win the constructors' title again? Is everyone feeling confident in your camp?
Yes, 100%, no doubt. And it's not judged by this win or the good result today. We always believe that we can do it and fight until the last minute. So they better don't count us out, especially, I think, considering the engine trouble we had for this race. Who knows, it might pay us back and favor us in the last few races.
Well, I tell you what, I haven't been watching much of Super League this year. I certainly will be now, because that was, I think that's going to be a very popular win in the paddock, to be honest. So absolutely well-deserved, Florian. Outstanding drive in the truest sense. And we're just going to quickly head on over to your teammate. Oh, thank you for coming, Florian. You didn't have to, of course. But we get to talk to your teammate as well. David Fyerduk, 2014 champion, weakened engine, one-stop strategy like your teammate. You've taken the lead of the Drivers' Championship again with a very solid P4. I mean, it just seems like a great day's work for you guys.
Talk to Flo more, man. He deserves it. Jesus, what a race. Man, this is the most disappointing race of the season for me, but I'm over the moon. Like, I've never been happier. Like, only I know, like, how much effort and time Florian puts into this car and the setup, and he reads every single detail on Motec, aiming for every thousandth of a second. And, you know, I couldn't be happier for him, man. You deserve it. And yeah, and many more to come, Flo. Well done, mate.
You know, this sort of actually marks quite a nice full circle moment, doesn't it? Because, of course, you two were teammates all the way back in Formula Challenge 3 years ago.
Well, yeah, not just that. We've been in another league together, and we were teammates for quite a while, and we dominated championships there. Field not so strong, obviously, but, you know, we've dominated another championship. We came into this, I came into this league looking for a bigger challenge, and I kind of like pulled Flo along with me. He was kind of comfortable in the other league, but I said, you know, come over, it's good, you love it. And since then, you know, we've always been fighting to get in the same team. We know what each other likes. I mean, I could skip 2 weeks of testing, turn up to a race, and he will know the exact setup I need, and I kind of hope I can do the same for him. I mean, we did well this race, we were pretty much on the exact same setup. My race, yeah, my start was pretty poor. We tried something new. Didn't hook up at all. Excuse me. Didn't hook up at all in quali, but managed to keep P4 over Bart. And then the first few laps, normally the last few races, I push my tyres too hard and they wear off really quickly. So this time I wanted to take it easy, look after them. I didn't mind the other guys pulling out a bit because I knew what we would be doing pit stop wise. But then the middle of the first stint, I locked up bad and started losing like 5-6 tenths a lap to Florian. And yeah, that pretty much decided my race, because after the first stop, it was just too little too late. I was even pushing out of my skin to stay ahead of Michael, who's got behind me, you know, from the pit lane, which was incredible. But yeah, I can't say much more. I'm disappointed for myself, happy on the other side. I'm back in the lead of the title race, but yeah, more happy for Flo. Yeah,
I think it is time to perhaps wrap up the speaking and start up the celebrating, certainly. As I say, probably one of the most popular wins we'll see here at the GPVWC in quite a long time. But thank you to both the Nordschen boys for joining us here today. That said, there is still plenty of racing action to come in the year. It doesn't stop here, believe me. Next week, we're back with the Independent Series, starting off on the Monday when we return with the International Touring Cup. We're heading to Estoril in Portugal. Will we see Adam Taylor retain the lead of his early championship hit over there? I don't know what I'm doing. I'm lost for words. I apologize. Portuguese Touring Cup. It's going to be great fun. Go and watch it on Monday. And then on Thursday, we're back with the Atlantic Series for the Grand Prix of Indianapolis. Not the oval one, the inner circuit one. That's the one. There should be plenty of good racing there as well. And then, of course, in 2 weeks' time, we are back with the career ladder, where our European season is done and we head over to the land of the rising sun. It's Open Series and Formula Challenge at Suzuka on Tuesday, the Super Cup on Wednesday, and, of course, the Japanese Grand Prix on 2 weeks' Thursday's time. So that's all from us. I'd like to extend many big thanks to Menoclomp once again for stepping in on our cameras. I'd like to thank Mr. Kacper Kolodziejczyk for joining me as co-commentator here today. I've been James Kirk, and from all of us here, it is a very warm goodbye.